ఈ వీడియో కనుక మీకు నచ్చినట్లయితే లైక్ చేయండి, షేర్ చేయండి. ఇలాంటి మరిన్ని అప్డేట్స్ కోసం మా ఛానల్ను సబ్స్క్రైబ్ చేసుకోండి.
Let me express my gratitude to the organizers of the seminar, in particular Ivali Saab and Sudha Madam, for giving me an opportunity to share some of my thoughts in about 10 minutes about the historical and sociological context of the evolution of composite culture in Telangana. The chief guest has very eloquently highlighted the characteristic features of cultural interface between the Deccan and Persia. It will be superfluous on my part to repeat, but sir, I would like to conceptualize the nature and characteristic feature of the mixed or cosmopolitan culture of the Deccan in general and Telangana in particular during the Qutub Shahi period in terms of four pillars. One is Khanka, Darga, Urs, Muharram and Ashurkan. In my view, these symbolize the incorporation of the popular culture that existed in the land of Telangana and among the people of Telangana into this cosmopolitanism. As we all know, the Qutub Shahis were part of the Persian elite. In fact, the Deccan witnessed and it was a part of the Persian commonwealth, so to speak. And therefore, they were able to negotiate with the local cultures and integrate themselves into the popular folk culture of this region. So therefore, I would like to view this cosmopolitanism and the mixed culture of the Deccan and Telangana in particular from people's point of view. Sir, the roots of this popular culture lay in the evolution of Telangana culture from the ancient times. Sir, if Qutub Shahi rule symbolized religious tolerance, peaceful coexistence of religions, and the incorporation of the values from the outside, was very much rooted in the Telangana side, as Professor Lavanya mentioned, that the roots of the popular culture in Telangana go back to the Buddhist period. It was Gautama Buddha and his message which in fact paved the way for the popularization of Buddhism as a social democratic thought. And Telangana now dotted with a number of Buddhist manuscripts, Buddhist monuments, the stupas, the chaityas, the viharas, and if one looked at the social basis of Buddhism in Telangana, it was drawn predominantly from amongst the artisan communities, the professional communities, the adivasis, the nomadic groups, and the women. It is the influence of Buddhism on this land and the people that paved the way for the coexistence. Sir, way back in the ancient past, the Shatavahana rulers, though they patronized Buddhism, they also encouraged Hinduism. Then from Shatavahanas to the Chalukyas, we found the coexistence of different religions, Buddhism, Jainism, Vaishnavism, Shaivism. And it culminated during the Kakatiya period, because Kakatiya rule was an important landmark in the history of Telangana, which enriched the identity of this region. So the mutual coexistence of different religions, even though the rulers had faith in a particular religion, for instance, Chatavanas are Buddhism, Ikshvakus are Buddhism, Vishnukundins in Hinduism, but within the Hinduism, the various sects that flourished, like Shaivism and Vaishnavism, were made part of it. So therefore, what I was trying to suggest, in the regional location of the Deccan, and in its distinct social formation, and in this cultural formation, the ethos, the ethic of this coexistence was very much there. Therefore, when the Qutub Shahis established their political rule, they were able to follow the long established tradition. Secondly, sir, unlike in the north, unlike in the Aryavarta, in the Deccan, Hinduism was not a monolithic religion. Hinduism was not a monolithic religion. Here in south, in the Deccan, we had within Hinduism, Shaivism, Vaishnavism. Both these two sects taught social equality, social harmony, social justice. In fact, it was Ramanujacharya who in fact propounded the entry of the so-called untouchables into the temples. He was the early exponent of the concept of social justice. So it is again, sir, a continuation of the Buddhist thought. Buddhism emphasized social equality, social justice, and coexistence. And the third important point to be remembered is that when Sufism entered, as I said, Islam as a religion had displayed certain democratic features which were welcomed by the local people. The kind of message of Prophet Muhammad was very much familiar to the people of this region. Therefore, they were receptive. And here, one of the important aspects to remember, the conversions that took place, because some of the historians, some traditional historians, tried to argue that conversions have taken place because of the misrule of the rulers. The forceful conversions have taken place, they argue, which is not historically true, sir. It was in fact the spread of Sufism that in fact won the hearts of the people. Those segments, those professional communities, artisan communities, the excluded communities who are attracted to the ideas, to the ideology, to the thought process of Islam and Sufism got converted into the other religion. Therefore, they carried with them some of those traditions which were integral to their culture. Therefore, Sufism. And here again, Sufism was a popular religion, it was a folk religion, it addressed the needs of the people. Here I would like to draw your attention to the role of the Fakir in spreading the Sufi message. Fakir, as a follower of Sufism, was an integral part of the village society. And he catered to the needs of the village folk. If there were some illness in a family, he would go and offer. You know, he would cure. And some of them are said to possess certain magical powers. So the Fakir was integral to the village community and to the village folk, therefore he was accepted. And then Kanka was a place where the Sufi saints preach, you know, and carry out deliberations. In that, all are welcome. So that social gathering, irrespective of caste, community, gender, was an important factor in convincing the local populace about the significance or greatness of this particular sect. And thirdly, Darga, as we all know, Telangana is a region where, in fact, Dargas dot across the region. And people pay particular homage, they respect, just as they do in the, you know, popular Hinduism, to those who are pious men. And the Sufi saints were able to incorporate the ethos, the ethics, and the cultural manifestations of the folks, particularly, as I said, artisan and the professional communities, and this, those communities which were away from the orthodox Brahmanism. And therefore, sir, the historical legacy of Buddhism, the contribution made by the non-Brahmanical sects like Shaivism and Vaishnavism, created a cultural situation where Sufism could flourish, and the Qutub Shahis as rulers were able to preside over a society, over a culture, which was quite mutually dependent upon. And therefore, I keep telling to the young students about the distinct characteristic feature of Telangana culture. For 450 continuous years, this region was ruled by the so-called Muslim rulers, and there was no recorded evidence of a communal violence. Why was it so? This has to be, as a student of history, I would like to argue that this coexistence, this tolerance, was inherent in the folklore, in the popular culture. Therefore, when we are, sir, after the Telangana new state was formed, we are trying to rewrite our history and culture from people's perspective. And here, you know, we need to really look at those aspects of the Telangana culture which in fact promote, you know, social harmony, coexistence, and concepts like, you know, social justice. And today, in the reconstruction of Telangana, we need to really promote those values, those ethos, which were positive in nature. Today is a time when the new state is being formed, when reconstruction is going on, and to address some of the issues, sir mentioned in our discussions in the room, the way that the government is encouraging the education of the minorities, for example. Of course, they have schools for OBCs and so on. Sir, education in this part of the country, in Telangana, has been bestowed irrespective of caste, community, gender, was the first Buddhist Vihara. In Buddhist Vihara, in Buddhist Sangha. So the concept of education, devoid of any religious content, was the contribution of the Sangha. In the medieval times, sir, the Vaishnava Mats, the Shaiva Mats, because the so-called Sudras and the so-called lower caste, the occupational caste, they were denied access to the so-called knowledge of the God or language of the God, Sanskrit. But you know, these heterodox sects, Jainism, Buddhism, they gave education, knowledge to those who were deprived. So then came Sufism. The kind of teachings that took place through oral, you know, recitation and through oral communication has enabled them to acquire, you know, some new consciousness. And of course, in the modern period, we know that it was advent of Christianity, which in fact took the knowledge to the doorsteps of the Dalit Bhajans. So therefore, sir, this is the historical continuity. And to understand the essence of the Telangana culture, its basic characteristic features, they are rooted, you know, in its religious, in its spiritual, and in its cultural ethos. And therefore, in seminars like this, what we, through our interaction, what we do is to spread this message through our study of the past, of preaching coexistence, tolerance, and progress through imparting knowledge to those who have not been able to acquire it so far. So in that sense, this seminar will send a kind of a message of the distinctive features of the Telangana culture and the contributions made by the various dynasties, including the Qutub Shahis, for making this religion a safe place for live and let others live and promote this concept of peaceful coexistence. Thank you very much, sir.
ఈ వీడియో కనుక మీకు నచ్చినట్లయితే లైక్ చేయండి, షేర్ చేయండి. ఇలాంటి మరిన్ని అప్డేట్స్ కోసం మా ఛానల్ను సబ్స్క్రైబ్ చేసుకోండి.